everyone, I'm Jeff Gaskin and welcome to the LA's The Place Kitchen. I've been joined today by a very special guest, Marco Pierre White, and he is an incredible chef from overseas. How are you doing today?
Very well, and very privileged and very honored to be here.
Well, I've got to say, you are doing something that is very impressive for a chef of your caliber. You're taking the secrets of professional chefs and you're making it very accessible to us folks that like to cook at home, and you know, maybe we have a limited space, a small kitchen like this, but you're showing us how we can take simple ingredients and make incredible meals, right?
Well, cooking at home is not easy because you haven't got all the equipment. Mm-hmm. You're limited with space. So I always say keep it simple.
Okay.
But the secret to good cooking at home is a great quality stock. And whether you're making a braised dish, whether you're making a risotto, whether you're making a soup, you have to have a great stock.
Okay.
Without a great stock, you will never get the desired effect that you require. So when you cook at home, you have to keep it really simple.
Mm-hmm.
Really simple, because you know, we've got one pair of hands.
Yeah.
Our assistants are in the cupboard behind you.
Yes.
Bottles, jars, packets.
Mm-hmm.
So when I cook at home, I tend to do most things in a pot.
Okay.
Because pots have more flavor than a pan.
Really?
Okay, every so often, a grilled piece of fish, a grilled piece of meat is delicious.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I like to serve the pot in the middle of the table. So I like making a risotto, I like making soup, I like making a big braised dish, a stew.
Yeah, and those are very family friendly. Everybody likes to dig in when you can present it at the center of the table. The family can really come together around the meal.
It's simplicity, really. At the end of the day, you put it in the middle of the table, a big lump of bread, some vegetables or a nice big salad. Keep it simple, keep it friendly. Because why should cooking be stressful?
Yeah.
Cooking is a way of life, it's not a job.
And it's something you're going to be doing, you know, upwards of three times a day, so you might as well get comfortable with it.
I don't know about three times a day, but I've got a full-time job. But what I'm going to cook for you today is something very simple.
Okay.
Really simple. And it's a risotto with asparagus.
All right.
Very, very simple. We have our onions, our rice, our parmesan, our asparagus, and olive oil, and a little white wine.
Oh, yeah.
But the secret to a great risotto is a great quality stock.
All right.
And I accept that people can't make great stock at home. It's mm-hmm. difficult. Why? Because they don't have the equipment.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. So therefore, what do I use? I use a very simple product called Knorr Homestyle Stock.
All right.
Four tubs. That makes me 12 cups.
Okay.
But I just keep it in my cupboard. It's very simple. And so the beauty of this stock is that one, it's great to cook with. But secondly, it does the seasoning for you.
Yes.
Because one of the great fears at home, when people cook at home, is they've made their dish and they're scared to season it. Why?
Mm-hmm.
Just in case they over-season it.
Yeah.
And then you've spoiled it. So Knorr Homestyle Stock does the job for you.
Perfect. Well, sounds good. So this risotto looks like something very simple to make, and you've got asparagus here. Do you cook the asparagus at all beforehand, or are you taking it straight raw?
The asparagus has been blanched for 1 minute.
Okay.
The stems and the tips.
Okay.
It's very, very simple. As I say, once you start the dish, in 20 minutes, dinner's served. It's one of those great dishes you can bring your family in and make it with them. You can have it for a dinner party and bring your guests in.
Yeah.
They can stand around with their glasses while you're doing a bit of sweating, a bit of stirring, but you know something? It's a very impressive dish for dinner.
That is true, and I found it's a lot of fun sometimes having your guests in their kitchen with you, whether you're just cooking for one person or a few. A lot of good conversations happen in the kitchen, and you can share some techniques with your friends.
Well, I bring everyone in the kitchen at home. So if I'm having a dinner party, they all come in the kitchen.
Oh, cool.
Even if it's a braised dish.
Yeah.
They see the fat boy from Leeds doing his bit, you know, in the kitchen.
But anyway. Nice. So are we ready to take this over to the stove?
We're ready to go.
All right.
The first job we're going to do is we're going to take the Knorr Homestyle stock and dissolve it in water.
Okay.
Once we've done that, then we can start.
Alrighty.
As I say, risotto, without doubt, is one of the easiest dinner party dishes in the world. Once you've seen it once. A lot of people have never made it. A lot of people try and make it, but they don't make a great risotto. The secret to risotto, as I said, is a great stock.
Alright.
Once you've seen it, you never forget it.
And you think people are intimidated by it because the end result looks so complicated?
I think people think, oh, that's stirring. But when you think, it's not that hard.
Yeah.
As I said, cooking at home is a way of life. It's not a job.
All right, Chef, well, show us how simple it is.
There we are. Now we have to go over here.
Wow.
So, if I go this side.
All right, I'll switch with you.
The first step is to take our Knorr Homestyle stock, which comes in the little tubs, and we just dissolve it in our water. As you can see, just pop it in. and then just whisk it. And once it's dissolved, we're ready to go.
And Nora's already handled all the guesswork of putting the proportions together and making sure that you don't need the seasoning.
It's a very simple recipe. 3.5 cups per tub, which is a generous amount of salt.
Yeah.
But the beauty of it is when you cook, you don't need to season. It does the job for you.
That's nice.
If we ask ourselves the most obvious question, which part do people who cook at home hate most?
Over something.
It comes to the seasoning.
Yep.
They're scared, and that's why when you go to friends' houses, the food is under-seasoned. But Knorr Homestyle Stock does the job for you.
Excellent.
So as you can see, it's dissolved.
Already smells very good, and we've only got one ingredient.
The beauty of the stock is you'd think you just made it from scratch. It's delicious. Now, so we swap over, and the next job is to take our onions and to cook them without colour. And the reason why we cook them is to remove the water content within them.
Right.
So as you start to cook them, you smell the acidity through the evaporation of the water. But once the water's evaporated, we've removed the acidity and you have the natural sweetness and the natural flavour of the onion.
Oh.
And that's key to when making a risotto. It's key because you want that sweetness.
And that's probably why if someone's had, you know, raw onion on maybe a burger and then they've had sautéed onions on a burger, it tastes very different.
They're two completely different things. I mean, if you ask yourself the most obvious question, what tastes more of an onion, a cooked onion or a raw onion? What tastes more of tomato, a cooked tomato or a raw tomato?
Yeah, you get more flavor when it's cooked.
That's right, because you've removed the water content, and you've removed the acidity, and allowed the natural sweetness of the tomato or the onion to come through. It's like cooking mushrooms. What do? You remove the water content. By doing that, you intensify the flavor of the mushroom.
And does that hold up for all things? Does it hold up for meats as well?
When you're cooking meat, what you want is that nice caramelization.
Yeah.
So you get that nice grilled or that nice roasted flavor.
Okay.
And you want it nice and moist in the middle. I like my meat medium rare. So as you can see, I'm cooking the onions.
We've got just onions and butter in there, right?
And a little bit of oil, just a little bit of oil. And one thing, when you're making risotto, once you've got the heat into the pan, you've got your hot stock, you shouldn't really have to change your gas level again or your electric.
Because
a good pan will always hold the heat.
Yeah.
So as you can see, there's my finely chopped onions.
Wow, the smell is incredible.
But you can smell the sweetness, you see.
Yeah.
And the beauty of cooking is the scent of food. It makes you want to cook.
Indeed.
By frying onions, by cooking tomatoes, by roasting meat.
And it lets everybody in the house or wherever you are know you're cooking as well.
So as you can see, there's our onions, all the water content. There's our onions, all the water content has been removed. We take our rice, and we go with the rice. It's an arborio rice, which is the proper rice to use for a risotto. So as you can see, I've added my rice. I'm mixing my onions and my butter and my olive oil in with the rice, so all the rice is coated. As you can see, I've distributed my onions throughout. So get some heat into the rice. Get it down one side. So now what we do is we take some white wine.
Nice and generous?
Not too generous.
Okay.
Generous enough. We bring the wine to the boil. By bringing the wine to the boil, remove the alcohol content, the acidity, and again we bring out the natural sweetness of the wine. And so as you can see, we bring it to the boil, reduce it down a bit, the acidity from the wine removes, and we have the natural sweetness. What we're doing is building layers of flavor.
Excellent. And when cooking with wine, does it matter what variety of wine you use, or say you've got a half bottle of white from 2 nights ago left over in the fridge, can you go ahead and use that?
When you cook, you know, use the wine you like to drink.
Yeah.
That's the romantic approach. So if you like a straightforward white wine from Napa Valley, which is dry, use that white wine.
Okay.
So just use a splash of it and drink the rest. Simple.
Excellent. I like that. A little one for you, one for me, maybe two for me.
So as you can see now, Jeff, even at this very early stage, the rice is starting to absorb the liquid.
Okay.
The acidity is almost gone. exactly. I just work the rice. And the reason why you work the rice constantly is one, so it doesn't stick to the bottom of the pan.
Okay.
Two, so the rice cooks evenly. Mm-hmm. So people think, oh, risotto is tough to make. You will see how easy it is to make. It's not tough. You know something? It's not a job. It's a labor of love.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
And now, how did you get your start in the kitchen? I understand your father was a chef?
My father was a chef, my grandfather was a chef.
Oh, wow.
I was born into very humble beginnings in the north of England, mm-hmm. in a very working class town, a very hard town called Leeds. And in those days when you left school at 16, you followed your father's footsteps. Your father worked down the mines in Yorkshire, you went down the mines. Your father worked in the factories, you went to the factory. My old man, my grandfather was a chef, so I followed them in their footsteps.
So was it kind of a natural thing? Did you hang out in the kitchen a lot when you were younger? Or did they really try to guide you towards getting into the kitchen?
As far as my father was concerned, it was a job. Hmm. As he said to me, he said, Marco, cooking will never make you a rich man. But there'll always be a cook required. You'll always have a job. You'll never be employed. Oh. That working class logic. He said, and what you learn in the kitchens will enrich the lives of your children and your family. You feed them. It's a life skill, it's cooking. It's not a job.
Very cool. Excellent words.
So as you can see now, the wine's almost evaporated. And now what we start to do is add our stock.
And you don't add it all at once, right? You add it in layers?
So I'm going to add. Three, now just mix that in. And what will happen is, so you start to feed your rice the stock little by little.
Okay.
And what happens is the rice will start to absorb it, but at the same time release the starch. So as you can see, already the rice is absorbing, releasing the starch, and there we are. We just keep on working our risotto. Bring it down from the sides and work it back in. Some people like to use a wooden spoon. My mother would use a wooden spoon. She was a veronese, she was Italian.
Mm-hmm.
So when she made the risotto, it was always a wooden spoon. And if she was alive today, she'd still use a wooden spoon because old habits die hard.
Yeah.
But if you want my honest opinion, use a spatula because it gets into the corner. It helps you bring the starch back in, which washes up against the walls.
And can really make sure you get everything off the sides of the walls so you get that even cooking you're talking about.
But you can smell the poison.
Oh yeah, you can smell each ingredient in there too. You can smell the wine, you can smell the onions. You can really smell that broth. The stock is really good.
And that goes back to what I said at the beginning. It's a stock designed for cooking. It doesn't overpower. A lot of stocks overpower.
Yeah.
And what I want to do is taste my asparagus. If I'm braising pork, I want to taste my pork. Mm. I don't want the stock being the dominant.
Yeah.
Flavor.
Now, I've got to ask you your opinion, since you're considered one of the original, if not the original, celebrity chef, and people that watch TV today, they're noticing there's so many TV shows out there. What are your thoughts in general? Because when I view a show on TV that's about cooking, it seems that they're becoming less and less about the food and more about the drama or the personality behind the food.
I'll answer that question in two parts. One, the greatness of TV with food, it's created awareness.
Mm-hmm.
It's inspired people to want to cook. So that's what's important to me.
Yeah.
Whether you learn anything from TV is by the by.
Mm-hmm.
But what's important, you inspire people to buy better produce, you inspire people to want to cook, you inspire people to want to feed their children and their families better. That's what's key. And so therefore, when I do TV, maybe I'm old fashioned, but I did come from the old world of gastronomy. Mm-hmm. I came from Escoffier's world. I saw the tail end of it, and I saw the modern world. I lived the golden age of gastronomy. When I step onto the stage of TV in England, I'm very basic, I'm very simple. One, I'm there to do a job, to do my job well. Secondly, I have my chef's whites on. I'm an ambassador to my industry, to the world that has looked after me, given me great opportunities, allowed me to create security for my children. As long as you're prepared to work hard, roll up your sleeves, Be respectful. Keep your head down. There's a career. Even if you only last 5 years within the industry, what you take with you is the ability to cook. And that's the beauty of the industry.
I see.
You feed your family well.
Now, when you're in the kitchen, in the different restaurants, or maybe restaurants where you've just owned, have you noticed, is there a general kind of attitude in the kitchen? A lot of times when you see on these TV shows, for people that don't know a lot about the behind-the-scenes work of a restaurant, it just seems like the head chef's barking out at orders at everyone, and everyone else is kind of screwing up at times. Does it help to be, you know, feisty in the kitchen and yell out orders? Or is it because you're on such a time constraint, if you screw up one dish, you screw up basically the whole table's dishes because they have to wait for that person's entree to be remade?
Consistency is born out of discipline.
Good point.
And a proper chef, and a chef who leads from the front, will cast his presence over that kitchen. He won't have to belittle.
Yeah.
He won't have to swear. Just his presence is sufficient. And the only shouting to be done is the shouting of the orders on and the orders off.
Good point.
And so when I walk into my kitchen, they know I'm the boss.
Mm-hmm.
But by the end of service, I've worked harder than anybody, and I'm dirtier than everybody else. My apron is far dirtier. And you have to lead from the front. If you don't lead from the front, the team behind you will not respect you.
Very true.
And that's the same in every world. So as you can see now, sorry to stop you there, as you can see now, the rice is starting to really absorb the stock,
yeah,
and release the starch. You can see that creaminess beginning.
Mm-hmm.
As you see, look, we're having a chat. We could be having a glass of wine. We could be having a beer. It's not stressful, is it?
No.
It's about demystifying what a risotto really is. It's so simple. What is it really? We're honest with ourselves. It's stock and rice and just a little bit of stirring. So you see, so by stirring, one, you stop it from boiling.
Okay.
Because what you're doing is you're incorporating cold air, so it just keeps it off the boil. So there's very little evaporation, which allows the rice to absorb.
Okay.
So as you can see.
Because I was wondering with some risottos, if you were to add all the ingredients and just let it go, but you were really taking care of the rice first, slowly getting it to the perfect tenderness, and then the other ingredients come in.
I've always said, in a kitchen, perfection is lots of little things done well. And there's lots of chefs I know, it doesn't come natural to them, but they're very disciplined, and they do lots of little things well. And some of those individuals have achieved greatness, not because it came natural to them, because they were disciplined. And consistency is born out of discipline, every time.
That's why I'm sure chefs don't just walk right into the kitchen, their first kitchen, and become great chefs. You learn little bits and little ways to be perfect along the way, and over time, you add all those things together to become the perfect chef.
When I was a young boy and I started in the industry, the only thing I was allowed to say was yes, chef.
Hmm.
It didn't matter what job I did, it was yes, chef. Sometimes I got given lots to do, the most mundane, boring jobs in the world. But there was a simple philosophy. The quicker you work, the more you learn. And it's as simple as that. Because you push out those bad jobs, and then you get to the good jobs. But the thing you learn most within a kitchen is your eyes, and your nose, and your palate. Taste every empty pan. So when I was a young boy in the sauce, my chef to party, I was the apprentice. I'd have to take the pans to the washer and get them rewashed. I'd always taste the sauce.
Yeah.
So you're educating your palate. I'd always watch the chef, I'd watch the fish chef, I'd watch the chef on Flamettier. I'd look around me, I'd see everything. So even though I wasn't on that section, I was learning. It's amazing what you learn with your eyes, and then smelling. And like I said today with the onions, you smell the acidity, but then you smell the sweetness come through. And so you know something? Cooking, it's a way of life. It's never been a job for me, and that's why I work 7 days a week. It's just something I love doing.
Excellent.
So as you can see now, our rice has really expanded. Just bring it down from the sides. And the beauty of risotto as well, you take the pan and you put it in the middle of the table and you serve your family.
Mm-hmm.
You're engaging. That's what eating is all about. It's about engaging. I've been asked many times in my life, what's my best meal I've ever had? know what my best meals are? The meals I have at home with my family sitting down around the table, not in a great restaurant.
Yeah?
That's you know something? And I love cooking for my children. Why? Because every time I feed them, they grow that little bit more.
Yeah.
That's the beauty. Because the only thing within my industry, which never dates, is romance. Everything else dates. Including the chef. Getting older.
Well, you've accomplished so much as a chef, and I'm sure you had all these inspirations when you were younger, but what inspires you now? What keeps you going back and wanting to create more in the kitchen?
My real pleasure today is sharing my knowledge with everybody, encouraging people to cook, inspiring them to cook, to make them want to cook. That gives me more pleasure than winning 3 stars in Michelin. Because a regular in my restaurant came once, twice a year. Because 12 years ago, I was 300 sterling ahead. So I cooked for strangers every night. But today what I do, for example, with Knorr Homestyle Stock, I share my knowledge. I take the knowledge from the world of gastronomy I came, and I bring it into the domestic kitchen. And sharing my knowledge with people, which allows them and encourages them to go home and have a go, feed their families better. That's my job today.
That's awesome.
And that's where I take my pleasure from.
Well, that's really great. And a lot of restaurants, sure, people are giving their guests these great dishes, but you are one of the few chefs, especially at your caliber, you want the viewers at home to know exactly how to make your great dishes, and you want them to pick up the techniques as well. And I think, as you're mentioning, that seems to be just as important as the end result, is getting the techniques right. You said lots of little perfect things go into making a perfect dish.
I can't turn someone into a 3-star chef. That's something they do to themselves. But what I can give them is 3-star discipline. It's that 3-star discipline which enables them to cook really well. But never forget, perfection is lots of little things done well.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can keep that in mind when you're chopping onion, when you're cooking it in a little butter to remove the water content, to remove the acidity, to allow the natural sweetness. Because never forget, cooking is a philosophy, it's not a recipe. Unless it's pastry, then it's chemistry, which is a science.
Yeah, interesting.
So there you can see now.
So you've added all the stock at this point in separate amounts, and it's starting to thicken. Are there differences, is in a chef's opinion, on how thick or how kind of wet you want the risotto to be, or is there a standard in the industry?
My mother was a Veronese, from the north of Italy, Verona. And my mother used to make a risotto so it walked on the plate. My mother would never serve it in a bowl. Okay, today I'm giving you it in a bowl, but Mum would never have done that. She'd always put it on a plate. So it walks across the plate. But some people like their risotto a little tighter, a little heavier. Me, if I'm honest, I like it like my mother cooked me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you know, it's what you like, that's what's important. You put as much parmesan or as little parmesan into your risotto. You put as much butter or as little butter into your risotto. That's your choice when it comes to finishing it. And if you don't like butter and parmesan, use a bit of mascarpone. Perfect. So as you say, can you see it's now coming together?
Mm-hmm. That's great.
Let's expand it. So this has been cooking now for about 15 minutes. It needs a little bit longer. But you can see, look how low my heat is.
Mm-hmm.
If your heat's too high, the stock will evaporate before it's absorbed. So understanding heat when you make your risotto, obviously a good pan. Once the heat's in the pan, then you can knock back the heat. So that's very good. You can see it's just bubbling. But we'll be stirring and knocking it back from reducing. What you don't want is to reduce your stock. You want it to be absorbed.
Now, I understand you've also written a couple books. Are your books more about cooking, or are they more about lifestyle, or are they a little bit about each?
Well, I've done a few books in my time. Many years ago I did a book which was called Whitey. It was 25 years ago nearly then. And that was me as a young man with a very famous photographer called Bob Carlos Clark, who unfortunately is no longer with us. But that was a revolutionary book, not because I did it. It was the first time anyone ever had insight into a kitchen, so there's lots of black and white pictures. And 20 odd years on, it's still produced today.
Yeah.
I did my autobiography, which was interesting. And then the latest book I've just done is Marco Made Easy. It's a cookery book where there's no technical ability required, just a little bit of confidence.
Nice.
Most of the ingredients are in your kitchen cupboard.
Excellent.
Bottles are your best friend, as I said. Your home style stock is your best friend in the kitchen. And when I say this is the best stock on the market for the domestic kitchen, I really do mean it. Because if I didn't, I wouldn't be standing here now making risotto for you, Jeff. Because you cannot question your integrity in everything you ever worked for. You have to stand up and fight for what you believe in. You know, be a realist. The domestic cook can't make proper stock because she hasn't got the time or the equipment or the money a lot of the time.
Yeah. Now, your goal of making all these great techniques and recipes accessible to the home cook, have you gotten any backlash from the chef or the culinary community? Maybe people don't want you exposing the simplicity of making an incredible asparagus risotto when they'd rather, you know, they would come to their Italian restaurant to try it.
If we're honest, you can't criticize a man for making a living. You can't criticize a man for sharing his knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
You can't criticize a man for enriching the lives of other people.
Very true.
Going to a restaurant to most people is a treat. So let's share the knowledge within our restaurants with the people.
I like it.
Now, we take our asparagus, which was blanched for 1 minute. See, just some.
Now the stems, you said you blanched for 1 minute?
I blanched for 1 minute. So there okay. We are. And what we do now, we just stir it into our risotto. I take my stems and I incorporate them in. I take my spears again. You can either incorporate them in or you can sprinkle them on top. Just toss them in a little olive oil, hot olive oil. And when it comes to serving, just put them on top of your risotto if you want for garnish and sprinkle with a bit of parmesan. But I'm quite happy just throwing them in.
Yeah.
For me, it's all about eating.
And I want to ask you, as a chef and a big fan of food, what is the importance between texture, taste, and presentation? Are they equally important? Does one have an overall writing on you? Because if it doesn't look good, people often won't have the chance to taste it because they just think that doesn't look good.
Great chefs have three things in common. And maybe this philosophy will answer your question. Firstly, they accept and they respect that Mother Nature is the true artist. They are the cook. Secondly, everything they do is an extension of them as a person. And thirdly, they give you great insight into the world that they were born into, the world that inspired them, and they serve it on their plates. Why try and make food look like something it's not? Respect Mother Nature for what she is.
Yes.
Produce is beautiful. Leave her be. Just cook her perfectly. Now, we take our parmesan, we sprinkle our parmesan over the risotto, and what we want this to do now is slowly melt. We take some butter, and again, butter is to our choice. As much or as little, it depends on your palate. The palate should always dictate. As I said, if you don't like butter, use mascarpone.
Okay.
There's our butter, we've made a bit of risotto. So that's taken us about 18 minutes. So as you can see now, there's our risotto. Just let that melt a little bit. Probably about 78%. And then what we do is we incorporate it in, which gives it that creaminess.
Okay. So you let it melt on top, and is it a slow? Well, I'm sure you're going to show me, but when you say you incorporate it in, that doesn't sound like to me like you're just stirring. Are you layering it in?
You work it in. So when it started to melt, as you're seeing it happen now, it starts to melt, the cheese is melting, the butter's melting. Just before it's all completely melted, take that pan and you work it with your ladle. So you incorporate it in, but what happens is it makes it very creamy. And so that's how you get a nice creamy risotto. But again, I like butter. You might not. You might not like parmesan. Maybe you don't like parmesan, you don't like butter. Then they use the mascarpone. It's neutral. And whenever I do a shellfish risotto, I always use mascarpone rather than butter and parmesan.
Really?
Compliments it better. So the last minute of cooking is allowing the cheese and the butter just to soften, to melt over the surface. And when it gets almost completely melted, that's when we work it in with a spatula and bring it in and give it that creamy texture. Mm. But again, your palate dictates. If you like cheese, put a bit more in. If you're not so keen on Parmesan, take some out. Your choice. Your palate should always dictate. And if you allow your palate to dictate, then you'll cook well. Because you only cook things you like to eat.
Yeah.
Remember, a recipe book is only there to inspire you, to guide you. It's like a watch. Time should never dictate. Mm-hmm. It should only guide you.
Now, speaking of guiding you, when you come to a city like Los Angeles, where we are, of course, what do you look for when you go out dining? Do you like to go for a restaurant that's got a big following, a high rating, or are you looking for kind of a small, unique experience that's, you know, maybe family-owned?
I want something very simple. And, like this evening, I'm going to Mozza, Mario Batali's restaurant. Mm-hmm. But I'm eating in the pizzeria side. It's one of my favorite restaurants in LA. It's proper, honest food. Served to me in an environment that I want to sit in. Mm. Because for me, the most important aspect of any restaurant is the environment I sit in. If I don't feel comfortable, it doesn't matter how good the food is, I'm not going back. Environment is key. Friendly service is key. Food of a very good standard is key. Do I want to sit in a restaurant which is soulless but serves fantastic food? No. Mm. I've been very privileged in my life. I've dined and worked in some of the best restaurants in the world. So I've seen most things within my industry. And you know something? I want to sit down with my family and friends, I want to break some bread, have a glass of wine, and just enjoy my evening. It's not that important to me anymore, as long as I have a good standard.
Nice.
So as you can see now, there you are. You can see it's almost melted.
That's good.
I hope you know that, because we work again.
And again, this whole time, since, like you said, you used the perfect stock, you never had to add any salt, you never had to add any other basic ingredients that would also involve the guesswork that you might risk over-salting or over-seasoning.
The beauty of the Knorr homestyle stock, it does it for you. And you can serve it, and it's almost perfect. The average palate. But let's not forget, some people like a little bit more salt. Mm-hmm. Some people like a twist of black pepper. But if you're just the average person, it's perfectly seasoned.
Excellent.
So you see, there we are, so we work on the risotto. This is a little heavier than my mother would make it. You know, it's how the average person likes it. So it's a standard.
Let's it smells so good. That's the one thing that's lacking in television shows with cooking is smell-o-vision hasn't been invented yet. That's the next step.
But you know, you have to create smell and taste. Because the viewer cannot eat it. Mm-hmm. They can't smell it. So they have to trust you with your words. Most people on TV make food look pretty. You don't want to eat it when you look at it. For me, it's about looking at food and then wanting to eat it. It's about inspiration. So you create the smells, you create the flavors with your story. Because you know, as I've always said, when I judge a chef, I always listen to his philosophy. His story, and then I eat his food. Mm. But I ask myself one very simple question. Are they consistent? And great chefs, you listen to their story, you listen to their philosophies, and you eat their food, and it's consistent. Mm-hmm. Because let's not forget, painting by numbers is one thing. Cooking by them is something else. Mm. Enjoy your risotto.
Thank you, sir.
It's a pleasure.
Incredible asparagus risotto. If you want to get more information on Marco, on Knorr, or to get some great recipes, just go to facebook.com/Knorr.